I'm Dennis Anderson along with Julie Kellner, and here's what's coming up on Almanac North.
The Duluth-Superior Film Festival celebrates its 8th year. We have the festival director and the founder in the studio tonight.
We'll also talk with award-winning author Linda LeGarde-Grover about her most recent book of poetry.
And we'll talk with a recent college graduate who is planning to walk 585 miles to raise funds for local college programs.
We'll also have the week's top business stories and dig into the news file archive for a story from 25 years ago. It's all coming up on Almanac North. Well, hello once again and welcome to Almanac North. Thank you very much for joining us on this Friday night. And Julie, we've got a lot to cover, so let's meet our first guests.
Thank you, Dennis. Over 5 days, the Duluth Superior Film Festival will deliver an exciting slate of film, music, and art to the Twin Ports and surrounding region. In its short history, the festival has developed an exemplary reputation for presenting a distinctively imaginative lineup of international, American independent, and regional films. Joining us tonight to tell us more about the festival is director and founder Richard Hansen. Thank you so much for being here.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much.
Can you tell us a little bit about what film goers can expect?
Well, like you mentioned, there'll be international and festival hits, a lot of regional productions. That's something we really try to focus on, films that are produced within the region, Minnesota and the surrounding areas, things that have a strong local interest.
Richard, what's the mission of the film festival? You've been around now for just a few years.
Yeah, this will be our 8th year, and our mission really is to provide quality cinema in a festival environment and have quality presentation and make sure it's a professionally run festival so that it and then bring the tremendous work from around the region, but also from around the world.
And where will these films be shown?
Opening night will be at Clyde Iron, which it has been for quite a few years. We're very excited about that, a film called Rumble. And then we'll also be predominantly at the Zeitgeist Arts Complex and Cinema 2 and Teatro. But we'll also be up in Cook, Minnesota at the Comet Theater.
The Comet Theater, been in there many a time.
Oh, we love it. We absolutely love the Comet, that's for sure. Yeah.
And now I understand that we have a little bit of a clip to show our audience from Rumble.
Very good.
Indians who rock the world.
You're an Indian, but be careful who you tell.
All of a sudden, I was talking about Native American issues and big-time television. And all of a sudden, everything disappeared.
From Charlie Patton to Link Wray, Robbie Robinson invented the genre. Jimi Hendrix is the best in his field. Jesse Ed Davis, everybody wanted him. Well, that's interesting, isn't it?
So are these screenings and discussions? What can people expect when they go in? I understand they can get in for free.
Absolutely, yep. We went to the free model in 2014, and we're happy to be able to do that again. But we try to eventize just about every single one of the films in some way, shape, or form. Obviously, opening night is our big night, and so we have a reception that follows and food and things of that nature at Clyde, so that's always fun. But even the individual screenings, we like to have guests, usually directors or producers or actors, and you will almost always do an intro beforehand and a question and answer after, so people can really engage with the artists.
So Richard, how are the films selected? Is there a board that sits down and makes decisions?
We actually have our assistant director, Jordan Brown, she lives in Austin, Texas, but she's from Hermantown, actually, Duluth.
Yeah.
And so she is combing the festivals around the country, looking for quality films. I spend a lot of time with the regional productions because I have a close link to that, and I've got a history and a background of covering all that. So it's a wide web of people who we know, contacts, but also reaching out to individual filmmakers and things like that.
And speaking of films, I understand we do have one more clip to show as well, and this one is called Bloodstripe. So can you tell us a little bit more about this film and just about what the film festival brings to Duluth culturally?
Well, we're very pleased to be screening Bloodstripe, and that will be up in Cook, Minnesota. That will be our film that we're going to be screening up on the range at the Comet Theater. And we like to do that because that particular film was shot in that region a little more than a year ago. Mm-hmm. And so bringing the film back to the area where it was produced and where it was filmed is really important to us, and we've had some really good success. Last year was terrific at the Comet, and we're going to do that again.
I'm glad you brought that up, because there were a number of films and some big films made in and around the city of Duluth as well, not just north of here. So have you tried, if you can, to try to get locally produced films into the film festival?
That's one of our key parts of our mission, actually. Local films will always be a part of the film. In fact, we've come to find that there's a lot of Duluth filmmakers who are producing really fantastic work. We've got quite a few shorts and even a feature that has been shot and will be in the festival this year. Mm-hmm. We're really excited about that. But regionally, Minnesota, the Range has a great rebate program. Minnesota has a great rebate program. And so it's really important for us to.
One year, did you show You'll Like My Mother, or have you?
We did. We did that a couple years ago. Yeah. The Dear Patty Duke. She was.
She was here for that, was she not?
She was, and she changed my life. To be honest, I'm gonna get a little teary-eyed. Yeah. She was an incredible human being, and we're very sorry she passed.
So can you talk a little bit about your own experience and how you started down this path and your interest in film and film festivals?
Sure. I actually started out like a lot of people who are interested in the film industry. I thought I was going to be a director or a that whole thing. I was a producer for a while. I realized that I was not talented as a director, but I was much more of an administrator. I just came to find that I could get people together much better than I could direct. So as I became an administrator and a producer, I realized that my greatest strengths was in the film festival world. Yep. And I was at the Minneapolis-St. Paul International Film Festival when I lived in Minneapolis. And then I also worked as the director of Sound on Scene, which is a films on music festival. And then I moved up here to Duluth with the very intent of starting the Duluth Superior Film Festival, and met my wife the opening night of the first first festival.
Who typically attends a film festival?
Well, there's a wide range. Strangely, we do find that our audience skews a little bit older, surprisingly. Yes. Yeah. So we've got a little bit higher percentage of seniors or the 55 plus, and quite a little higher percentage of women as well, strangely. And that is actually a focus of the festival this year. We're going to have a lot of female directors, and we're paying a lot of attention to indigenous issues and women in the director's chair.
A lot of folks miss the old single screen theaters. Are you trying to keep these in single screen theaters?
Well, the old single screen theaters, that's one of the things that we're trying to accomplish.
They're hard to find.
Well, the Comet's one of them.
Right.
Yeah, the Comet is a good example.
Yes,
in fact,
indeed.
The longest running single screen theater in the state for sure, but it might even be the country.
Okay.
I mean, it's very, very old.
Yeah.
But a beautiful space. But yeah, we're also excited about the North Shore coming back in and all the rest of that. So.
And now, I know that this is self-serving, but Brew North, which was produced here at WDSE, will also be
it certainly will, and we're very excited about that. It's nice to and we even had one last year as well that was produced here. So that's just another nice example of something that is being made, produced locally, that we like to profile. And of course, Karen Sunderman's just a friend.
Are there any films currently being produced in northeastern Minnesota that might be shown somewhere?
There are quite a few, actually, and we pay close attention. We partner with the Upper Minnesota Film Office and Minnesota Film and TV Board and IFP and all these other producing organizations. There are quite a few. There's two that I know right off the top of my head, and a third that's coming down the pike. So yeah, we got plenty of room for more films for next year's festival.
And filmmaking helps the economy.
Yeah, it sure does. you'd be surprised how much income and generated through commerce, through food productions in the region.
Well, excellent. And it's a five-day festival.
Correct.
And so we're looking forward to hearing more.
Yeah, check us out at ds-ff.com and check out the lineup and grab a program and come on down.
Should
and
be another great year.
We're looking forward to it. Thank you for having
Thank
me.
You.
Yes.
Now, let's dig into our Newsfile archive for a look at what was making news 25 years ago this week.
Right now, only construction vehicles are permitted to drive on the final stretch of Highway 35, but not for too much longer. By late September or early October, the 3.2 miles running from Mesaba to 26th Avenue East will be open to traffic. According to MnDOT official John Brave, the project is going better than planned.
We have virtually a perfect project here in Duluth. It's environmentally sound. It's done a good job taking care of our downtown's air quality, stabilizing traffic flow, and in fact enhancing our use capabilities of Lake Superior.
Before the project can be complete, the public will be inconvenienced for a while. In August, the freeway will shut down for 30 days from 5th Avenue West to the end, 26th Avenue East. At that time, construction workers will make the final connections through the Leif Erickson Tunnel. But while that's being done, traffic in the city could get a little hairy.
At that point in time, we will be putting about 26 to 27,000 cars a day back where they always used to be, which is on the city streets.
As soon as the tunnel is complete, these dirt piles will be gone, and the new highway will be open for business. In Duluth, Laura Cowan, KDLH News.
Award-winning author Linda LeGarde-Grover's most recent book of poetry, The Sky Watched, Poems of Ojibwe Lives, was one of the works honored at this year's 29th annual Northeastern Minnesota Book Awards. Linda is a professor of American Indian Studies at the University of Minnesota Duluth. Linda, thanks for being here with us tonight. What does it mean to have won this award?
It means a great deal to me because it's recognition of the region and of people who live in the region and of my, you know, my work that I think is rooted in the region here. So I was terribly pleased and touched when my book was announced. Mm. It was a big surprise.
Big honor, isn't it?
Oh, it is a tremendous honor.
I just loved one reviewer wrote of your book, The Sky Watched. This is the first bilingual poetry book in English Ojibwe, not translations, but poems using both languages. Linda LeGarde-Grover's The Sky Watched is a poetic reaction, a wonderfully realistic voice, a spirit and essence of the Ojibwe people. Read it and be transformed.
Oh, my goodness.
Read it and be transformed. It's just wonderful. So can you talk a little bit about what inspired these stories? Where did these voices come from?
Everything I do, I think, comes from my own family's experiences, but also in the research that I did when I was working on my schooling, which I did over many years. And my field is federal Indian policies of about the last 140 years and those effects on families and individuals. And the focus is on northeastern Minnesota because that's where I'm from and that is where the reservation I'm a part of, Boyce Fort, is. And that is the beginning of this.
Linda, who's your intended audience for this book? Does it go beyond the Indian community?
Oh, I hope so. Our experiences are, you know, certainly unique in history in many ways, but there is a commonality, a brotherhood, I guess, of human beings. And so I hope that comes forth in these writings. I mean, certainly there are many difficult things that have happened in history, but there's also a lot of celebration and joy and, you know, real thankfulness for just being here. The Anishinaabe way, mm-hmm. you know.
So can you talk a little bit about how you balance the teaching and the writing? You work for the University of Minnesota Duluth and teach in American Indian Studies. How do you balance both of those kind of demands?
The writing is what I do as kind of like a special treat for myself, I guess. So I really and truly love when I get the chance to sit down and do a little bit of writing. I have a lot of stuff that I write all the time, and so I just pull things out of my box of stuff and work on them every once in a while.
Because my book club will kill me if I don't ask the question, how do you write? I mean, do you write a little bit every day? How do you kind of discipline yourself to kind of turn out these manuscripts, or is it a matter of inspiration?
Well, I think I lack discipline, because I love it so much, when I get the opportunity to, I do this. So no, I don't have a set schedule. It's whenever I guess I feel like doing it, and that's quite the luxury in my life. I teach, and then I come back to what I'm doing in the office. I go to meetings and endless, you know, things that we do to keep the university running, and then there's time to sit and work on something.
How did you select your material?
I chose it out of my box of stuff.
But are these lived experiences?
Some are. Mm-hmm. These are some of these are real experiences. People I knew had, some of my relatives, some of them are my own experiences, and some of it is you know, purely fiction, but it's based on real federal policy and reactions and survival, but also the real pleasure of continuing to survive. I mean, my dad, when we were kids, he told us every once in a while that, you know, when you get up in the morning, the first thing you should do is thank God for making you an Indian. And boy, when you think about something like that, all that implies, that there is something beyond ourselves, and we've been given this great gift. I mean, what better could it be? You know,
it almost sounds like a book of survival in some way.
It's survival, but it's also it's survival through some of it's kind of grim, I guess, and kind of sad. But there's also a lot of fun things and
joy,
pleasure. There is joy.
Voice.
Yeah, there is. What is it? Kind of an optimism. That's the way I was raised in my family. Isn't this great?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Look at all these marvelous things, you know? And so I hope that is in this collection too.
So what are you working on now, and what are you about to release? I understand that there's a new book just on the horizon.
I will have a book out this fall from the University of Minnesota Press, and it is called Onagamasing, Seasons of an Ojibwe Year. And it is short essays, and they are divided into seasonal themes. And they're my life and my experiences as an Anishinaabe woman of northeastern Minnesota.
When did you realize you had a talent for writing? Everybody doesn't.
No, I just enjoy writing. I've enjoyed writing since I was a little girl. My mother, once in the summertime, we had an old school desk out in the yard, and I think I was, you know, kind of bored and hanging around, so she gave me a pencil and a piece of paper and sat me down at the desk and said, here, write a poem. so I did.
A reviewer also wrote that your poetry reads like prose and your prose like poetry. How would you describe your style?
I think that's on a spectrum. And so I started at writing poetry. That was what I first wrote. And I didn't really write fiction till probably about, I don't know, maybe 10, 12 years ago. I started writing fiction. And so my books then, people say that they do read like poetry, and they are kind of a nice read aloud.
Wonderful. Linda LeGarde-Grover, thank you so much. Author of The Sky Watched, Poems of Ojibwe Lives. Thank you for being here.
Miigwech.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Kenneth Timm graduated from the University of Wisconsin-Superior on May 20th. This Memorial Day, he will embark on a 585-mile walk through Minnesota and Wisconsin to raise funds for local colleges and programs. Thank you so much for being here, Kenneth. So what inspired you to plan this trip?
It started from a place of gratitude. I feel very fortunate to have had the opportunity to get this degree and had a very good experience at UWS. Uh-huh. I wanted to give back in some way. And also after spending that amount of time in school, I really wanted to just go, to be out in the open and experience the world at that pace. So I thought maybe I could do that, do both things at the same time.
So obviously at some point you had this aha moment, I can do that, I'm going to take this long walk. To where are you walking and how long do you think it will take you?
Well, I'm walking straight south through Minneapolis and St. Paul, mm-hmm. and as far south as Dodge Center, Minnesota, oh. then straight east to Oshkosh, Wisconsin. I hope to average about 19 miles a day. So wow. the walking will actually take me about 30 days, but it'll probably take me more like 50 or 60 days. I have to come home and take some breaks,
sure.
things
uh-huh.
like that.
This would be a fundraiser.
Yes. Now, can you talk about that, the fundraiser, and who you are intending to benefit with the funds?
The fundraiser is, well, a combination of things. I'll be raising funds for UWS, also for Lake Superior College in Duluth. I got my associate's degree there. I'm also a pilot, and pilots can use a little bit of extra help with their training, with the money for their training. So there'll be a choice of one of those three.
Uh-huh. And as you're walking, you're trying to raise what, $75,000? Is
a
that what
total of $75,000?
And how can people pledge?
They can look at my website, which is www.freeinggeorge.com, and pledge through that.
Can you talk a little bit about that? What does Freeing George mean?
It goes back to when I was a kid. My family nicknamed me George, and George was a very creative and fun kind of person, but sometimes over time, things get a little bit buried. And mm-hmm. when I went back to school, I decided to free that person again. And the walk is sort of a physical manifestation of that.
So, Kenneth, how would someone apply for the funding that you're raising?
Well, it'll be donated or gifted to the colleges. And beyond that, I don't
they
have
will
much.
Determine.
Exactly. I don't have much control mm-hmm. over it after that.
Well, what a wonderful gift of your time and effort. Can you talk a little bit about what inspired you with your experience at UWS? You say that education changed you and the educational experience changed you. So how did that transform George?
It opened my mind again. After living a life, we kind of look at things in a certain way, potentially. And to be around young, bright students and dedicated faculty members, it helped me look at things in a different way.
Mm-hmm. You're taking this gift of education literally on the road. Here's some video of you mm-hmm. practicing your walk. This is going to be a long trek, and I suspect in the time you'll be walking that you'll be making some stops along the way, maybe giving a pitch for what you're doing?
I hope to talk to lots of people along the way. Mm-hmm.
And what are you pulling there?
It's called the wheelie walking trailer, and it's a really cool design. It puts the weight on the wheels rather than on my frame as I walk, which allows me to do this. I don't think I could do it without it. So it's a really cool piece that I bought just for the walk, and I love it. I practice a lot with it, and it's just a really cool thing to use.
Have you heard of anybody else doing this locally or to raise money for education for others?
Not this particular thing.
Yeah.
I have not.
I have not either, yeah.
Well, that's a pretty exciting thing, and you say that you've been practicing, or, you know, so how many miles are you up to now?
I've walked up to 15 miles a day.
Really?
We're all winter long, anywhere from 3 to 10 miles a day, walk, as much as I possibly could, as time would allow.
All the best to you.
Thank you very
Appreciate
much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
We'll be right back.
Well, it's time for this week's business news from the folks at Business North. A state appeals court has sided with the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency to assess one of the largest fines ever. Dale Sitch, Diane C. Anderson, and J&D Services of Northern Minnesota must pay more than $1 million for environmental violations and related cleanup costs. The MPCA alleges that they abandoned approximately 30,000 gallons of hazardous and non-hazardous waste on their property in Aurora, and then ignored an agreement to voluntarily remove the waste. The MPCA eventually declared an emergency and used public funds to properly dispose of the waste.
Cirrus Aircraft has received approval from the European Aviation Safety Agency to sell its Vision Jet in Europe. That decision follows similar approvals in the United States and Australia. It will allow Cirrus to ramp up deliveries, said Pat Waddick, president of Innovation and Operations, and will help open up new markets for the aircraft, which is manufactured in Duluth. The company has more than 600 orders for the 7-passenger Vision Jet, which is priced at nearly $2 million. Cirrus describes the aircraft as the world's first single-engine personal jet.
To address the shortage of skilled construction workers, the Northwest Wisconsin Workforce Investment Board and the Wisconsin Indian Head Technical College have partnered to offer Construction Essentials. The 10-week course teaches the basics of construction, building design, energy efficiency, print reading, and other concepts related to construction. Funded by public grants, it allows students to attend at no cost. A mini job fair will be held when the course concludes, allowing employers to meet and observe students while they work. An existing course will be followed by a second one this year, and more are scheduled in 2018. For more on these and other stories, visit businessnorth.com.
Well, if you have a comment about our show, call now, dial 218-788-2849 to leave a message or send an email to almanacnorth@wdse.org. And you can check the WDSE website when you're looking for program information, updates on station events, and other news here at your public TV station. Thanks for filling in tonight, Julie. Appreciate it very much.
It was so much fun.
For Julie and the crew at Almanac North, I'm Dennis Anderson. Have a safe Memorial Holiday weekend. Good night, everybody, and be kind.